So I will indeed speak about virtue spaces. To give you some context, I will start with a very simple example. So during this talk, I will try to be as elementary as possible. Okay. So I apologize in advance if you find it boring. So first, just to give context, let's take X, p-adic. Adic space. Okay, so there is a structure shift. P adic.
Yes.
P adic. P adic space is a bit short, no? Inside of it, there will be so-called OX plus, the ring of integers. Okay. And we can ask several questions about this shift. For example, what can be said? About the ring space X OX plus mod P, or mod P2N, for example. More specifically, what is the category of quasi-coherent shifts, for example, of OX plus mod P2VN? What about the global generation bisection? Say on affinoid. Maybe it is true, maybe not. And so on. So by the end of this talk, I will provide answer to these questions, or at least to the right analog of these questions. And in particular, for X affinoid, so spa of affinoid Uber pair, I will give you explicit algebraic description of such modules, for example, in terms of just elements and maps. So, of course, if X is perfectoid, you probably well know that there are almost answers to these questions. Okay. So, for example, OX plus mod P to VN is almost quasi-coherent. So, what are my motivations to study these questions? So, first, as I just said, the perfectoid equivalence. Which say that if A is perfectoid, we have an equivalence between the almost A algebra and almost algebras over, for example, A mod P or A P to V. So question is there something analog in without the perfectoid hypothesis? So of course it's not true as stated, but maybe we have some quantitative analog if we remove the perfectoid hypothesis. Okay, so this is one motivation. Another is an old theorem of Deligne from the 80s, Deligne's equivalence, which says the following: if K is a complete discrete variation field with perfect residue field, then the category of finite etal extension of K with amplification slopes at most n So in terms of Galois representation, it means that Gn plus trivially, then this category depends only on OK mod mk to the n up to equivalence. There's actually a stronger statement shown by the Lien that if we add an extra structure on this, namely a generalized Cartier divisor supported on the maximum integral, then it becomes up to unique isomorphism. Okay. There is a functoriality behind it. So this is for a complete discrimination field, or a perfect reduced field. The perfect was almost removed, basically removed by Hattori. So removed by Hattori 10 years ago. But we may ask what happens if we replace this by just a valuation field, Hänselian valued field, not necessarily discrete, and arbitrary residue field. So of course, to make sense of this question, we would need to talk about ramification for arbitrary evaluation ring field. So for motivation is ramification actually. So there's a step to generalize to valuation ring. But more generally, we could ask about globalization, actually. Of the Abbe-Saito ramification construction. So by globalize, I mean in families of valuation, in other words, over evaluative spaces. Like the Riesz-Kerman spaces or adic spaces. So globalization. So first for valuation rings, there was a Abbe-Saito construction was adapted to this more general case by Saito in 2019 and by Kato Tate in 2020. So it's actually more general in this paper by Kato Tate, where they consider it's a very beautiful picture when they tell us the difference about logarithmic, non-logarithmic, and defect and non-defect extension. So it's a very beautiful article. So what are the problems when we try to globalize this definition? So there are two different phenomena. First, I will explain this in more detail later, but at some point we will need to get rid of some depth 2 subspace. So yeah, what's important is not the codimension but the depth. It's a bit of a technical hypothesis. So we need to discard some depth 2 subspaces. And there is a tool which does exactly that, and I will call it phi rings, phi ring or phi scheme. So I will tell you more about this. And also, we will need to categorify our objects. Categorification of objects. So this happens when we consider graded rings. So the relevance of graded geometry to the study of evaluative spaces was really put forward by Temkin in the early 2000s. In particular, there are various results in graded geometry that were first proved by Temkin using this technique. For example, considering organic properness, for example. So graded rings, there was also work, of course, by others. For example, Ducrot works a lot with these.
etc.
So now I will explain this, and I will start with categorification. What do I mean by that, and why do we care? Sorry? Okay. Okay. So yes, categorification. Kazako. So, for example, just at the beginning, so outset for me will be replaced by a groupoid. And a groupoid for me will be an essentially small category with invertible arrows. Okay. And my notion of ring will be the following. I replace them by symmetric monodular category with some hypothesis. I will ask to be it to be co-complete. Co-complete means it has small colimits. And I will put a finiteness assumption. And I will assume that the unit object for the monodial structure is compact. Okay. So, okay, so this is a category of sets. Here we have two categories. This is a two categories of groupoids. So the morphisms are the same category of just functors with network transformations. Here we have a category of rings. Here we have two categories that we will call, say, for example, categorified rings. Okay. The functors, the home in categorified rings, will be the monoidal, strongly monoidal, continuous functors. Okay. So this is the object of my category home, and the functor, the morphism of a natural transformation of strongly monoidal functors. Okay. So of course, when I start with a ring, I can associate to it what I will call underline. Underline is just the category of modules of A. Okay. It satisfies this hypothesis. And there is a very easy lemma that A maps to mod A, or A underline, is fully faithful in the sense that home of AB, if I transform it into a groupoid, by just considering as a discrete groupoid, then the natural functor to home of AB is an equivalence of groupoid. Okay. And of course, what is the SSL image of this functor? So A is in the SSL image. If and only if the natural functor from A to the category of modules over A1, where A1 is the ring of endomorphism of a unit object, then if only this is an equivalence. Okay, it's very easy, of course. Okay, so for now, I'm just saying that I haven't lost anything or gained anything by categorifying my objects. Now, maybe a little bit more subtle. I will consider rings modulo depth 2 ideals. So, what is it about? Yeah, so I haven't said, but this A1 is actually a commutative ring because of the symmetry of a monolinear structure. So we never leave the commutative algebra world. Mm-hmm. So now rings modulo depth 2 ideals. Okay, so we consider a ring. And I consider phi, a family of constructible closed subset of spec I, such that if so phi is stable by finite union. And also, if Z1 is included in Z2, and Z2 is in phi, then Z1 is in phi. Okay. So this is called a family of supports on the topological space. Here, I assume that these supports are constructible. This is the only variation. So phi is a Cartan's notation for family of supports. Okay. And I will assume that the cohomology with supports over spec A over structure shift is zero if Q, Q is less than 2. So this means actually that the ideals defining the closed subsets in phi have depth at least 2 in A. Okay. And now we consider the category A phi, which is the category of A modules, M such that, likewise, they have depth at least 2. So if I replace 2 by 1 here, this is just saying that the module is torsion-free. Of course, torsion-free modules do not form an abelian category, but remarkably, this one is abelian. Okay? And there is a little lemma. Actually, it is an object of a category phi ring, as above. So little lemma. A phi maps to this category phi ring is fully faithful, again. In the same sense, you have to replace the set of morphisms by the discrete coupoid corresponding to it. And there is also an easy way to recognize the essential image. So A is in the essential image. If and only if the natural transformation... Wait. Oh, I forgot to define it. So it's just home of 1x. Okay. So this commutes with Fedak filter colimits because of the hypothesis that one is comp. Where? Second line here? Yes, here? Home AB? Oh, of course. So if I take a set E, I consider E on the line is a discrete groupoid. Yes, exactly. So discrete groupoid is just only one automorphism by object, and that's it. Okay, and yes, so this means equivalence. Fully faithful, essentially surjective. So I was saying that A is inverse image of this functor if and only if the same functor as before, which checks x to home 1x, is fully faithful. Okay, so if you see an abelian category with this property, A to A1 is fully faithful, there is a phi ring hidden behind it, a ring with a phi structure. Okay, maybe I can give you the construction. Oh, morphism of A. Okay, I can write it. So A phi A to B phi B. So it's a morphism of rings such that for all Z in phi A, the inverse image by the corresponding spec of F, if you like, spec of F minus 1 of Z belong to phi B. Sorry? Equality, it is an element of phi B. In other words, in terms of ideal defining the closed subset, we are saying that if I define the closed subset in phi A, then the ideal generated by I in B is also defining an element of phi B. So yes, so it's different from the notion of a topological ring. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So you know the map from A to A1, the line is difficult, then how can you then you can recover the underlying ring as an endomorphism unit?
Exactly.
How can you realize phi?
That was what I was going to write. So as was just said, indeed, so the ID of the lemma is just exactly so A1 will be indeed the endomorphism, is just what we just said. And you need to construct phi over this. So we say so Z, the vanishing locus of finely implemented equation. So this is the general form of constructed by a closed subset is in phi if and only if this morphism is epimorphism in A. Okay? Or in other words, it is a cover in A. So, of course, you have to check that it is indeed a phi structure and that it is induced an equivalence between A and A underline phi, A1 underline phi. Okay. So, I will leave that as an exercise for you have bored. Yeah. Okay. So, this was a toy case just to introduce you to what I was going to. So before going to that object, I will actually be interested in. Now I'll talk about graded ring. So graded ring, it's more subtle than it looks like. I mean, the objects are very simple, just graded rings. But the morphisms of graded rings are very complicated. Oh, more complicated than what you might think. Okay. Okay, so first, a little reminder. So what is a p-cargopoid? So it is symmetric, monoidal, groupoid, with invertible objects. Okay. So for example, if you have a two-term complex, Then the category with objects equal gamma zero and morphism from gamma to nu equal d minus one of nu over gamma is a Picabo point. Actually, any Picabopoid which is strictly symmetric is of this form. Strictly symmetric means the symmetry is identity on x tensor x. Okay. So the stratification of groupoid. So you see, this is just a categorification of abelian groups. Now, if I have a categorified abelian group, I consider a graded object over it. Okay. So if P is a Picard groupoid, I can consider the category of functor from P to abelian. And this is a monoidal. Monoidal abelian category. So the monoidal structure is induced by the convolution product with respect to P. Okay, maybe I watch it. Okay, so monoidal structure is the convolution, imagine that M tensor N evaluated at like an element of P will be a colimit of the nu of M of nu tensor N nu minus 1 gamma. Colimit over the obvious diagram. Okay? In particular, there's a notion of monoid in abelian category, monoidal abelian category. Donc, let A be a monoid. So, A monoid in this monoidal category. For me, it is the same thing as a p-graded ring. Okay. Basically, if, for each element of object of P, you have an abelian group with composition. Okay. Of course. Now, why am I talking about this? So if A is in categorified rings, as before, we can consider its Picard group. Oid. This is the invertible object. So tensor invertible of tensor invertible objects of A, okay, with isomorphism as a morphism. And then you have a natural graded ring, which sends a gamma in P to the home of one gamma. And this is a monoid, so it's a P-graded ring, Picard-graded ring. Okay. Une fois, transformation pour Picard groupoid. Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, for the definite property of tensor product, you have to define what you mean, and you have to put a two cell in one direction or the other. I mean, the actual truncation, the not the naive one. Yeah. Yes. I think so, but you need to be careful about what universal property you are trying to solve. But, just, yeah. Which universal property? Oh, this is a tensor product internal to this category. Okay, I take M and N inside. My M is just a functor from P to Ab, a tensor product. You can think of the case where P is discrete, so just abelian group. This is just abelian group graded by this say gamma, for example, gamma zero. And here, this is the tensor product of graded group. So here, the colimit is not filtered. It's usually direct sum plus the morphism. So now we have a lemma. So A is of the form modules. Yes. What do I do?
I want to ask if the. So when you say monoid, you mean commutative monoid here, or monoidal abelian category is also with symmetry?
Yes, symmetric, always symmetric.
Okay.
Everything is symmetric. So the right question is, do I assume strictly symmetric for the Picard-Groupoid? For now, no. So for example, the category of super vector spaces would be an example of a category of modules of a p-graded ring.
And also when you write that A is a monoid in a monoid in func P up, you mean always a commutative monoid?
Indeed, yes.
So you mean commutative graded ring in this?
Yes, everything is commutative. When I say ring, it is commutative ring. When I say monoid, it's a commutative monoid. When I say set, it's just set.
Okay.
So A is of the form modules over a p-graded ring. If and only if the functor from A, so here I called A lower star, it is the Picard-graded ring associated to the Abelian category. I can consider the category of graded modules over it. So this is always a variant of the same functor. Here it's a line associate home of 1 to x tensor L. Okay. And now we ask this to be an equivalence. Okay, so this is the essential image in this case. So the thing is that this category, two categories of categorified rings is very large. So we need to restrict to a very special case. Okay. But this is too special for what we need. So now I can make a definition, and these are the objects I will actually be considering. So a graded phi ring is an object A of categorified rings such that A to A lower star modules is fully faithful. So you see, in this apparently simple data, there is a lot of hidden data, namely a graded ring and a family of constructible support on its graded spectrum. Okay. Okay, so these objects are more general than the one I considered before, but are still close enough to rings that you can consider spectra and such. Okay, so let's A be a category phi ring, as above. I consider a set spec A. These are the equivalence classes of A to modules over a field. Okay. And then there's a topology on it. If I take a generalized catcher divisor, so let me remember, generalized catcher divisor is just a homomorphism from a unit object to L, an object of the Picard group. Read. Okay. So generalized because for actual catcher divisor, you would assume it is injective. Or monic. So if such S, I define a subset D of S. These are the points of X, such that the section at X is an isomorphism. Okay. And I define this to be a basis for a topology. Okay. We get a spectral space, quasi-compact, quasi-spherical. So this space is not endowed with a structural sheaf. It is endowed with a structural stack of categories. Okay. So the structural stack is as follows. So OX on a distinguished subset D of S is the category of modules over the monoid 1S. 1S is the colimit of L tensor N. Okay, transition is given by S. So this is a monoid in A. And this is the category of modules in A over this monoid. Here it is actually a full subcategory, like for a ring. So here we are just inverting an arrow, inverting a Cartier divisor. Very simple. And of course, once you have this notion of affine, you can glue to get. But you should not think of these as affine, you should think of these as quasi-affine. Okay? Just like, so quasi-affine means that for a scheme, the canonical map to spec of gamma X over X is a quasi-compact open immersion. Okay? So this is the analog of fully faithful here. Okay. So quasi-affine schemes are all of this form. So Pn is of this form, so it's not affine. Okay, so we should think of quasi-affine. So, in particular, for Pn, you get here a description of quasi-correct module over Pn, which is exactly the one you find in SER FAC. Okay. So, the essential image of your graded modulus functor are the one which are of depth at least 2 with respect to the augmentation ideal. Okay, so at this point, you might wonder why am I talking about this? So here it goes. Now I will go from adic spaces to such objects. Okay, and we will see that we have a fully faithful embedding from adic spaces into, or maybe not this, but at least a formal object in this category. In a sense, why you should think of quasi-affine and not affine. So for example, when you take the ZRSK main space, inverse limit of blow-ups, what you get as a ridge space is just inverse limit of blow-ups. Okay? But these blow-ups, of course, are not affine. They are projective schemes over the base. Okay. So we need to take account of the fact that we also need to recover this projective spaces inside it. Okay, so here it goes. From adic spaces to this so-called phi schemes, if you like. I don't know, I'm not very good at naming objects, maybe you noticed it. I did not, in no paper have I defined it. Yeah. Yeah. maybe graded phase scheme, or I don't know. So Ducrew has anelloid instead of a graded ring. But the schemoid is weird. So. Okay. Anyway, whatever you call them, you serve objects obtained by gluing. So at these spaces, I will start with example. Let's take A, a ring. Phi as above. Okay, and I assume that A is pure. Pure means that there is no torsion. In the edge zero with support is zero. Okay, so let's admissible of A be the monoid of admissible zeros. These are the finitely generated ideals defining an element of phi, okay, it's a dual notion, okay, and there is a group which is very interesting, surprisingly, which is the groupification of this monoid. So monoid is for the product of ideals. Okay, so this plays the role of the value group in the global setting. Okay, if you start with a valuation ring with five non-zero ideals, so it is pure, and this gamma will be the value group of the valuation ring. And I have a graded ring by defining the graded piece here as the colimit of the J admissible of home of J gamma J. So gamma here is a fraction of ideals. So if I take J divisible enough, gamma J will make sense and I can define this. Okay, it will not define the choice of fraction defining gamma. And now I have a graded ring like this. And I also have a phi structure on it. So say F1, FR, are equal homogeneous of degree I equal very generalized by F1, FR is admissible. It defines an element of phi. Okay. So this seems rather technical, but actually you have no choice when you try to define it. Okay, so we get a graded ring associated to our very simple setting from the start. A graded ring with a family of constructive support on the graded spectrum. Okay, so these are all graded homogeneous ideals. Okay, so we get a category of modules of this graded ring. Okay, this is an example of a phi ring or graded phi ring as above. So proposition, let A be a complete, say, pi-adic ring, and let's stay integrally closed in A 1 over pi, so we get a Uber pair, and we take phi to be the finitely generated open ideals. Or the closed subset cut out by V. What is the conclusion? The conclusion is that the SPA adic space adic spectrum of when A, when the pi A, is actually the colimit of the spectra of this A lower star phi. Okay, so this is a category phi ring, actually a phi ring. It has a spectrum, but I will not consider this one. I will mod out by pi to the n. Okay, so it has a structural stack. And I take the inverse limit of these stacks, or in terms of spectra, the colimit of the n. Okay, and this is homomorphism of topological space with. So of course we need to say what is the correspondence between the structure shift or stack. And here the structure shift, O plus, will be equal to the inverse limit over N of the endomorphism at one like this. We recover the structure shift like this. And then the OX is just inverting pi. Okay? So in a sense, adic spaces are formal objects in these phi schemes. Okay. Which is why these objects there, which are actually the reduction modulo pi to the n of the adic space, is actually a simpler object than the adic space in some sense, in the same way that a formal scheme is more, a scheme is simpler than a formal scheme. So for example, here, if you want to compute sections, you have to assume something about maybe Deutanianness or uniformness or imperfect of it, for example, or at least some finitist hypothesis. But here, there's no such thing. Okay, no Deutanian hypothesis. So. Okay. I have 10 minutes. Is that it? That's all? It's just about being uniform, and uniform is also a finite condition in a sense. So no, for adic spaces, the only special thing about the perfect is being uniform or stably uniform, as you say. Okay, so now I have recovered adic spaces with their topology in this very simple category of things that look like a scheme. But you see here, if you want to go to a distinguished open subset, like a rational domain, what happens is that you take your ring, you take a blow-up, you take the integral closure, and then you complete. Okay? So there are several steps. The more complicated one is the integral closure. We're not sure what happens there. But here, you see, when you go to a distinguished open subset, all we do is just inverting an arrow, like for a scheme. Okay. So here we have relatively simple rings, but a very complicated procedure we apply to these rings. Here we have more complicated, like this is more complicated objects, but the procedures we apply to them are much simpler. Okay. So this is a trade-off. Huh? Okay, so as I was saying, so we just recovered the Zariski topology of adic spaces. What about étal topology? More interestingly, rigid étal topology. So as it turns out, these, for adic spaces, these phi schemes are not just phi schemes. They get an extra structure coming from the adic space, which is a logarithmic structure. Maybe before going into it, I can just tell you the link between logarithmic structure and these categorified rings. Okay. So if M to A is a log structure, then the fibers of this projection, there are M star torsors, but M star is just A star. So there are GM torsors of A. So they correspond to it a line bundle. Okay. So we get a map from this abelian group to the gallery of A modules, which take M to the line bundles associated to the GM torsor. GM torsor pi minus 1 m. Okay. So now we have a map from an abelian group to a category of. So of course these are invertible, so you get in the Picard group of it. Picard group actually. But here we can handle this with a structure of category by taking m as arrows, and then this becomes a functor, and this functor completely characterizes this log structure. If A is a local ring, then conversely, a functor like this from a symmetric monodeta category with invertible objects to A bar corresponds to a log structure. Okay. So this is the same. In general, if so a log structure on a categorifier ring is a monoidal functor, only monoidal functor. Say M to A, where M is symmetric, monoidal, with invertible arrows. Object, sorry. Okay. So, this is our analog of logarithmic structure. And in this setting, there is a natural log structure. Actually, already on Alex space, there is a canonical log structure. You take the elements. So here, you take OX intersecting the invertible element OX 1 over pi. Invertible. So this is a monoid. It has a map to OX. Yes, and this is the log structure. Okay. This is the canonical log structure. If you specialize to a version ring, it is exactly what you see. Canonical log structure in a version ring. So now I will skip ahead. You have notions of log etale, log lisse, log syntomic. So what will we do if you have a situation like this? So U here will be the open locus defined by a Cartier divisor, and Z the vanishing locus defined by the Cartier divisor, generous Cartier divisor. So we have topological invariance of log etale sites, in fact, X log etale restricted to Z is in equivalence with Z log etale, okay? Restricted to Z means you take the same topos, but you only take the covers which cover Z, okay? This is restriction of a topos to a sub-object. Okay, so etale is not very interesting. Let's go with syntomic now. Syntomic, and I take U etale. Restricted to Z, so this is log syntomic, relative dimension 0, and you have this I. Okay. For now, nothing has happened. Now, maybe some of you have already recognized what is going on, but this pull back, push forward is the Abbe Saito functor. Okay, so it does not take representable to its corresponding Abbe Saito variety. It takes it to the algebraic space, analog in this setting, of its connected components, which is what we want. Okay. So now we take a definition, a sheaf in X log syntomic U etale. So you can restrict it to Z if you like. As amplification bounded, so it's bounded by some ideal. Here the ideal is measured by our generous Cartier divisor, so bounded by S. If your adjunction So this is the final notion of amplification. If you specialize it to say, complete DVR, I don't know, with arbitrary resolution, what are we doing? So here, this push forward, so it's left adjoint of right adjoint of upper star. So what is going on if you take a Rosen table here, for example, like T over Z? We will consider morphisms from two in terms of algebra. Maybe I can explain it to you the case we start with adic space. So what is this I upper star doing? In terms of algebra, let's go back to the pi adic setting. Okay. So here, my z is defined by just vanishing of pi. Or pi to vn, but just change pi. Okay. So this is my x, this is my z. Now I take an object in this site, or in the corresponding site. It's an algebra. Now this algebra, we want to classify morphism to things like this. The I upper star of objects from here. So here we're trying to construct the adjunction, the right adjunct of I upper star. So what are morphisms from this to this? We just write B as AX to I. Okay. So of course this is surjective, so we can lift like this. There is a lift. Okay. Now it factors uniquely since the ideal I is sent to element divisible by pi. So I is divisible by pi. We need to stay in our category of Uber pairs, so we need to take integral closure. Okay. Okay. So any morphism from here to this gives rise to some morphism from here to here. But now maybe two maps like this gives rise to the same morphism. So we need to model out by an equivalence relation. What is the relation? So we next, so let's call this D. We take D tensor A, D. So this is the Cartesian product. We stay again in the category of Uber pair, so we take the integral closure in the ring or you invert pi, okay? And now we need to add the condition that to you. So here you have X here. And y. And you need to add the condition that x and y are the same modulo pi. So you just add x minus y mod pi. Technically, you need to take the integral closure, but it's not necessary. It is the same. OK, so this is our object. And if you look at it, it is actually, in terms of adic spaces, its pi will be an open rational domain. So we have an open subset in okay. So here we are taking the quotient of adic space by open relation, okay. And the result will be the analog of étale algebraic space, okay. And this one will parameterize the its fiber for a Bayesian ring. Will be the Abbe-Sato Fabre functor. Okay. Okay, so this is what I lower star does. And here we take I upper star. So first we start the situation over A and we just reduce it modulo pi. Okay. And if we get the same, so Fabre functor has the same elements as the original fiber, then we say that the sheaf is ramified at most. Okay, so this is Abbe-Sato construction.
Oui, donc merci beaucoup pour ce très bel exposé. Thank you very much for this beautiful lecture. So, are there any questions here in the audience?
Do you have a kind of micro-localization in this context? Like here you just, I was expecting that you have a product of two things and mm-hmm. you play with the home mm-hmm. of one to the other and take the diagonal and play usual game of micro-localization, micro-specialization.
Well, first, this makes sense for any shift of sets. So there is no abelian structure.
Okay.
So this is more interesting of constructing fiber functors for shift of sets. Okay. So the over-characterization for abelian shifts, like you said, like home of the upper streak. I'm not sure if it makes sense here and if it will give the same definition. I don't know. So the short answer is I don't know, but the objects I made so that we can at least formulate the questions.
Okay, are there any other questions in the room? So I think that Gaber has a question.
Yes, he raised the hand.
No, you.
You mentioned in the beginning the work on the Lin's theorem in the perfect residue field case for DVRs, and later there were several people that tried it. And finally, Atori used the fluid methods to. But I believe, I don't remember exactly, looking at what that there was some restrictive hypothesis in his result. Now, do you remember? Can you say? What was the hypothesis and whether you can improve it using your method?
Okay, so what Deligne, what was Deligne's result? So it was only for discrete variation ring with perfect residue field. So the reason is that to construct his equivalence of categories, he only used very specific models of these algebras. In this case, always the same thing. It's monogenic with a very special equation, Eisenstein equation. So it's a very simple calculation. Just like it's the same issue as why Abbes Sato, why it is more difficult to define the filtration, ramification filtration in the imperfect residue field case. And the same issue holds for this result. Okay. So the result is this, we take R DVR with perfect residue field. Okay. And you take, maybe you take truncated for to start, truncated DVR, so it's just DVR mod M to VN. Okay. You take M to VR, general as scattered divisor. Such that epsilon of M is Mason ideal. Okay. So this is a log structure, if you like, on the corresponding graded ring. So the graded ring here is this. Okay. So this is the graded ring, and this is the log structure. Now the result is that the line associates to such a triple R M epsilon. He associates functorially a category of extension of R, M, epsilon with a bounded ramification. Implicitly bounded by the ideal by which we have modeled. Okay. This is a functorial in the sense of two categories. And if we specialize to DVR mod N to N, we recover. So if it is okay, mod M to VN, M mod M to VK N plus 1, plus the obvious epsilon, then this will be canonically isomorphic just by reduction modulo M to VN to the category of an etetal extension of the K with ramification of plus M. Okay, so this is the Deligne result. Hattori, the result is weaker. Okay. So first, he only considers truncated DVR, which are killed by P, because at some point he wants to compare two different lifting of this truncated GVR, Katsik 0 and P, okay, and we need one to be in Katsik P. Both. Okay, so first there is this, and then Hattori does not have a functorial description like this, okay? He just says, if truncated rings are isomorphic, then the category of finite data extension are also equivalent. But maybe not canonically, and it's not clear what would be the canonical way to do so. Okay? So it's a bit quicker than the lean. So here I did not state any such thing, because I didn't want to state a result I did not have completed. So. But if this is what I was trying to do. So the goal is actually to generalize this. So it means to define this category of sheaf or Boolean ramification just in terms of data modulo the ideal, so over Z. So there's a natural there is a natural candidate, but I'm not sure if it is actually it is okay. It would be this category of eta algebraic spaces, which you get as I lower star, okay? So in terms of, for example, the evaluation ring, it would be a quotient of log smooth by open relations, and you consider the side by of all of these. And supposedly, the resulting topos should be the topos of finite etal extension or formation or plus the ideal by which we have quotiented. So this would be the conjecture.
Okay, so I also want to ask about your definition of ramification bounded by by I. You took a sheaf and you said that it's mapped to I lower star I upper star F, and this is an isomorphism.
Yes.
Now, what are the stabilities of this? Like, if you have, is it an abelian sheaf or a sheaf of set? Is it stable under sub quotients and natural operations like tensor products and not tensor? I don't know which kind of operations are.
Ah.
I mean, is it like a quotient of some group in the case of representation of some, like in the local case, in the case of evaluations, it gives a quotient of the Galois group? Or?
Yes, so sub-objects and quotient objects should also be of ramification bounded by, I think so, yes. But this is different for sheaf of sets, not just abelian groups. But yeah, it's stable by finite colimits. Yeah. Infinitely.
Okay, so thank you very much. And so we can thank the speaker again.